Hello everyone and welcome to today's webinar. Today we have Generics Group with us and they are going to be discussing food traceability, understanding your current capabilities. And our presenter today is Jeff Mc Caulou. And just to give you a brief introduction of Generics Group, Generics Group is formerly known as SoloGlobe. And they are a collaborative supply chain expert presently in 50 countries, thanks to its subsidiaries and network of partners. More than 5,000 companies around the world use its SaaS and on-premise solutions. And the group's 500 employees provide daily support for such customers as Carrefour, Domino's Pizza, Dan & Yogurt, Bic, and Volkswagen in the digital transportation of their supply chain. Its collaborative platform, Generic Supply Chain Hub, helps companies to keep the promises they make to their customers. It combines the capabilities to execute physical flows, digital information flows, and connect companies to all their partners in real time. And I just want to let everyone know that if you do have any questions, please don't hesitate to type them into the questions box. And toward the end of the webinar, we will get those called out during our Q&A time. And this webinar is recorded, so it will be available on our website at innovia.com later this week for you to review again or if you would like to share it with anyone. So now I'll turn it over to Jeff, and he will begin our presentation.
Great, thank you. Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us today. It's my pleasure to speak with you and discuss our topic of food traceability and its implications to your businesses. During our time together today, we will look at recent food recall history, reasons for recalls, regulatory drivers for traceability, explore a significant foodborne illness outbreak that highlights the need for digital traceability and financial impacts of recalls and traceability issues. And then we will finish with our exploration of the 11 criteria for evaluating traceability processes and systems. I'd like for you to think for a minute and answer a question. What do each of these food items all have in common? You'll notice some are a result of, say, a process like cooking, and others are harvested and processed for retail sale. You'd be correct if you said a food recall, or more specifically, recalls from this summer. However, all of these share another common link and a rather stealthy and dangerous bacterium, Salmonella. The CDC estimates that Salmonella alone causes about 1.2 million illnesses, 23,000 hospitalizations, and 450 deaths in the United States every year. Food is the source for about a million of these illnesses, and there's over 31 pathogens that are notorious for causing foodborne illnesses that the CDC checks. We've seen several cases of biological contamination, but there are other common reasons for food recalls, including mislabeling, which interestingly is what most allergen contamination cases are classified as, foreign matter contamination, where items such as glass or other foreign objects are finding their way into the food items. And often there are recalls as a result of processing machinery parts or remnants of machinery that are discovered in the finished item. Product defects would include food that wasn't properly stored, say at a correct temperature or something along those lines. And then chemical contamination, which can range widely from pesticide residue to even machine lubricants or cleaning solutions that find their way into the food product. Statistics such as these, and even more during the previous decade, provided the impetus for regulatory change. In the past two decades, there have been some significant regulatory changes that have reshaped the food industry. For the U.S., the Bioterrorism Act of 2002 and the Food Safety Modernization Act of 2011, and for Canada, the Safe Food for Canadians Act of 2012. the Bioterrorism Act changed the scope of knowledge for food supply chain participants, requiring that parties to know details about the products they sourced, including raw and intermediates, to the goods that they sold to their clients. They would be required to know new information about the supplier and the customer. The Food Safety Modernization Act focuses the FDA and the industry more on prevention with mandatory inspections, complete recall authority, and an increased security around imported food items. The Safe Food for Canadians Act is very similar to the Bioterrorism Act with regard to traceability, however. It requires parties to know details about the products that they've sourced, including raw and intermediate goods, all the way through to the goods that they actually sold their clients. So the Food Safety Modernization Act, the changes germane to our discussion today are Title II, Sections 204 and 206 that address food traceability and lot verification. The mandatory recall authority now granted to the FDA requires industry participants to be able to respond to the FDA tests and recall requests in a timely and complete manner. The Act changed business processes for everyone involved with the handling of food items. However, the changes impacted some more than others. Prior to the Act, some parties were on the periphery of regulatory changes. However, in 2011, the scope of coverage went upstream in the supply chain to growers and processors and downstream to transportation and logistics providers. Now, product and logistics information are required throughout the process, maintaining things such as lot identification and the ability to easily track goods and report on items that could be potentially recalled. Just this year, you may recall the E. coli contamination of romaine lettuce harvested in my home state of Arizona. This particular outbreak has surfaced some real issues with food contamination and traceability. Let's take a quick look at the timeline of the events for this outbreak. Sorry, went the wrong direction. On April 4th, the FDA learned about a cluster of E. coli infections in two states. The next day, on April 5th, there was a new cluster that had been identified, but it was reported in multiple states. And on April 10th, the FDA publicly communicated about the outbreak, but was unable to identify the food source. April 13th, health partners were able to identify chopped romaine from the Yuma region as a likely source, but were not able to fully verify or confirm where the lettuce had come from. On April 16th, just 3 days later, it was the final day of harvesting for romaine lettuce in the Yuma growing region. Then on April 27th, the outbreak of the same strain of E. coli at a correctional facility in Alaska was traced back to a single farm in Yuma, confirming that produce from Yuma was the source of the outbreak, in this case specifically head lettuce from a single farm. But this case was not tied to any of the other outbreaks except sharing the same strain of bacteria. The mystery continues as the source of the majority of the illnesses remained unidentified. Then on May 2nd, Arizona Leafy Greens Marketing confirms that romaine is no longer being harvested, but with a 21-day shelf life, the FDA could not be certain if the lettuce from the region was still available in the supply chain. On May 31st, the FDA released an update for ongoing traceback investigation. And finally, on June 24th, the CDC announced that the outbreak had ended. That's a fairly long timeline where the FDA and the CDC were involved in the food traceability and a traceback around the romaine lettuce. And it took a very long time for them to be able to identify the source. From March 13th to about June 6th, there were 210 illnesses reported in the U.S., covering 36 states, as we see on the map identified here. 96 people were hospitalized, and regrettably, there were 5 deaths, making this the largest foodborne outbreak in the U.S. in the last 10 years. While the numbers are not as large, the outbreak also impacted Canadians, where there were 8 illnesses reported and confirmed in British Columbia, Alberta, Saskatchewan, Ontario, and Quebec. So we're viewing a photo of a field in Yuma with a healthy crop of leaf lettuce nearing harvest. Arizona grown leafy greens account for about 1/5 of the national production of lettuce, contributing roughly $2 billion to Arizona's agribusiness. The Yuma growing region is the largest leafy green growing region in Arizona and accounts for up to about 90% of the U.S. winter grown leafy greens between November and April. During the months of November to April, romaine lettuce alone contributes over $500 million to Arizona's agribusiness, or approximately 23,000 per week during the harvest season. If you recall the timeline we covered, the outbreak began in March, but wasn't identified until April 2nd with the first 2 cases of illness. And even then, the source was unknown. The source was actually not identified until April 13th, and there was still 3 days left in the remaining harvest season. Given the shelf life of approximately 21 days, there was roughly 6 weeks of produce impacted by the outbreak and about 4 weeks worth of inventory targeted for destruction. The crop loss alone was between $90,000 and $115,000 in wholesale value direct to the farms themselves. The crop loss by itself was just the tip of the iceberg. The losses in lost sales of romaine lettuce, lost sales of other leafy greens, and the administrative costs associated with tracking down and destroying the crops greatly eclipsed the actual romaine crop loss. During the week of April 14th, when news of the outbreak broke, sales of romaine fell by 20%, and iceberg sales were down by 19%. Red leaf sales were down 16%. Sales were down by 17%, which pushed the total lettuce performance down well into double digits. In May, romaine sales fell nearly 45%, according to the Wall Street Journal. And iceberg fell 22%, while red leaf continued to fall another 17%. Prices for whole heads of romaine lettuce were down 60%. So not only was there a loss of crops, but the entire market, regardless of source or lettuce type, suffered significant loss in margin erosion. We haven't even begun to address the administrative costs and identifying and removing the impacted goods, let alone the PR costs associated with mitigating the damage to business reputations and rebuilding damaged reputations afterwards. The E. coli outbreak from romaine lettuce impacted all other leafy greens. Sales continued to feel the pinch into the following weeks, and the effects migrated to prepared foods as well. As lettuce sales continued to feel impact from the outbreak, concerns after the announcement that romaine lettuce was the suspected source, consumers shifted purchases towards organic greens and non-leafy items such as a slaw mix, as we see in the chart here. The outbreak caused huge losses for growers, a drop in sales for retailers, and disrupted supply chains as restaurants and other institutional providers scrambled to find romaine lettuce alternatives and new sources. The romaine E. coli outbreak highlights a significant challenge in the produce supply chain regarding traceability. The chart is a redacted copy of the FDA's traceback investigation from the point of sale, such as a grocer, back to the field. The solid lines represent examples where records are available to trace the lettuce from one party to the next. The dashed lines are where there are no records and only informal data through, say, interviews or other non-traceable means existed. There's only one straight line back to a single farm that I've highlighted on the chart, and that particular instance involves whole head lettuce, not even romaine, served in the Alaskan correctional facility. Since the lettuce was not processed or mixed with lettuce from any other farms, the source was fairly easy to pinpoint. All the other cases demonstrate how supply chain complexity severely impacts both the FDA and supply chain partners' ability to provide food traceability information, and especially in a timely manner. Consider how all the lettuce processed by the party in the middle, PR-A, is mixed and would result in cross-contamination for lettuce from any one of the 25 different fields on the right that supplied that facility. Or how batches of processed lettuce move between distributors, highlighting the need for lot tracking. The glaring issue related to this case is that, with the one exception of the head lettuce that made its way into the correctional facility in Alaska, the FDA was unable to determine specifically what farms or fields were the sources of the contaminated food until the outbreak had basically passed. They were only able to reach a conclusion on the growing area, Yuma, and only after 3 or 4 weeks worth of contaminated lettuce was circulating in the supply chain. So traceability is paramount, and in this case, it needed to be back to the field level to quickly identify the root cause of the issue. Traceability has become increasingly important because of some of the following trends. Just-in-time delivery. Products are increasingly sourced through global supply chains in a just-in-time model where contaminated products can spread across both state and country borders very quickly before the problem is even identified. There's fewer suppliers and complex supply chains. Just as we saw in the romaine lettuce supply chain, the partner relationships can become very complex, combining products from multiple sources into a single batch or lot. This increases risk in food safety, and when one supplier has a problem, it can affect many more retailers and consumers than in the past. Improved technology and practices for pathogen detection. There have been significant increases in the ability to detect pathogens, increasing the number of recalls and our knowledge of potential outbreaks. But this has a challenge to it as well, in that it increases the negative press exposure. Finally, the stricter regulations and enforcement. We began our time today reviewing some of the key elements in a stricter regulatory environment and the adaptation required to keep up with these changes. As recent news this highlights, transparency and openness is paramount when it comes to grocery items. Informing consumers frequently and clearly will build trust and relationships that will outlive occasional issues involving product recalls. When products are recalled, letting consumers know that potentially affected products have been removed from all areas in the store is important. It's also important that the store employees stay informed about any product-related health concerns so that they can sufficiently inform concerned shoppers. The more prepared a store is, the more trusting the consumer will be, and that will get them back buying much quicker with confidence. The important question is not whether or not we have food traceability that meets legal or regulatory requirements. We all do. We're required to by law in both the U.S. and Canada. But some better questions to ask are what kind of traceability does my company have? Or how well does it stack up against state of the art that's available in the marketplace? Or how effective are your current processes? How about what does your competition's process look like? To simply meet the minimum requirements isn't good enough anymore. You have to be ahead of others in the market. This brings us to the point that not all traceability is the same. The word traceability means many different things to different people. And so that's why we've taken the time to define 11 different characteristics or capabilities, as it were, of traceability systems. So you may remember from the blog announcing this webinar, one of the first items was compliance. Do your traceability capabilities comply with laws and regulations of all the countries, states, or provinces where your products are sold? Do they also comply with the requirements of your current and potentially future customers? Compliance is a topic that covers several different types of controls, ranging from laws to industry standards to corporate policy. When dealing with compliance, you're compelled to address the legal requirements based on laws and official regulations. Consider both the U.S. and Canadian laws that require businesses to know both their suppliers and their customers. This legislation in both cases simply requires that you know the key contact information, where the goods came from, and then any product information about what you've either purchased or sold. The focus is so that you can report back to a governing agency these important details when there is a recall or a traceback investigation. However, governing agencies do not typically define how companies are to capture or report on data such as this, leaving this to the industry to address. Most industries develop best practices over time to address both regulatory and business needs. Most often, these changes are expressed in the form of standardization organizations. The BRC, Global Standards, or Food Safety Alliance, or GS1 are examples of this. They all developed out of the industry's response to changing regulatory environment and the need to clearly define specific processes and practices that help the industry meet regulatory demands while ultimately improving their bottom line. Finally, companies have their own internal policies and rules that influence compliance. It's important to keep all three of these levels of compliance in view when considering a traceability solution, and specifically how quickly this solution can be adapted to any future needs on any one of these three levels. A snail's pace is not fast enough when addressing a food safety emergency, or if a regulator or customer asks you to stage a mock recall. How fast can you generate useful insights? Does your reporting cover all of your production for any period of time, including current production? Answering questions like this requires speed and timeliness. Speed and timeliness of data is paramount when dealing with food recalls, as evidenced by the romaine lettuce case that we looked at from earlier this year. Field-level information is not readily available from the growers or processors, resulting in a delayed public notification and source identification. In many cases, the data was recorded, but in an inefficient means, often paper, limiting the speed at which farmers or the FDA inspectors were able to trace back the contaminated lettuce. We need to look forward to a future state where all data is digitized, searchable, and reportable. This would enable agencies and supply chain constituents to trace back potential hazards very quickly. Like a game of darts where accuracy matters, would you bet your company on the accuracy of your data today? Traceability requires a significant amount of accuracy related to goods that are harvested or produced, including lot information, expiry dates, ingredients, quantities, sources, and even contact information, to name a few. The ability to have pinpoint accuracy should be the goal for all participants involved with food supply chains. The only way to provide this level of accuracy is through the digitization of both product and process data. The romaine lettuce case unfortunately demonstrates the need for accurate data to be shared from one supply chain participant to the next in a digitized model. When you approach a recall, is it as difficult as separating a single cord from this tangled pile to identify all the impacted items? How much of a fire drill is it to produce a tracing report? Or how many resources does it require? And how much does a mock recall disrupt your processes and your staff today? The efforts that you have to expend on a mock or actual recall are costly to your organization. There's lost time, product, and revenue that all quickly add up, as we saw in the romaine lettuce case. The ability to have pinpoint accuracy in a digital model significantly impacts your organization's efficiency when addressing recall situations. How much detail do your traceability processes contain today? Can you trace products and ingredients and packaging and even labeling back down to a lot level? Traceability for single items such as lettuce is fairly straightforward, especially when we think in terms of a single farm. The lettuce needs to be tracked to a field level to limit the amount of impacted produce in a recall. However, as we move away from the farm and into the processing center where the lettuce is washed, prepped and packaged for sale in multiple channels, we are faced with a different set of challenges. The lettuce is mixed with lettuce from other farms and fields, requiring a digitized solution for tracking. Now imagine having to keep track of ingredients from multiple suppliers, both raw and intermediates, in an internal mixing process or cooking process, and sales to multiple channels, potentially even including an omni-channel. The needs around traceability grow exponentially. And a pizza is a great example. A pizza has multiple ingredients and in many cases is made to order with a final list of ingredients as you personalize your pizza. We have an intermediate level that includes the dough, sauce, potentially the meats, and cheese. Each of these is made with raw ingredients that are likely sourced from different parties and ultimately came from different processes themselves. For example, wheat that is ground in the flour could have had a pathogen introduced at the farm, the processing center, or in distribution. The pizza maker needs to know when any ingredient or intermediate is impacted, so the stock can be pulled based on actually having been traced back to the impacted food sources, minimizing the loss in the case of a recall. The ability to quickly and completely identify all targeted items is important and increases in importance as we get into more complex food preparation. Do your traceability processes enable you to avoid the missteps that many may compromise food safety? For example, are they integral to your warehousing and manufacturing processes? Do they help you ensure that you don't inadvertently contaminate food products with allergens? Do they help you ensure that all your ingredients are fresh? There are many best practices that can be followed that help food suppliers from introducing food contaminants such as required washing processes or handling hygiene. However, Manual processes to avoid the mixing of products based on things such as an expiry date or a lot number require human intervention that are dependent upon memory. A digitized solution that combines warehouse management and manufacturing execution should allow you to establish systemic controls that control processes where goods can be mixed, alerting users to a potential problem, and maintaining control and separation of those items. The establishment of allocation or picking rules that prevent the allocation or selection of goods with expiry dates should be a minimum. But that doesn't address broader concerns, such as shipping goods that will expire in transit, or that don't potentially meet the client's specific minimum expiry date ranges. Again, a good traceability solution will incorporate UWMS and MES into the process, providing control over issues such as this. Can you trace backward to your source of supply? And can you trace forward to where your customers and the goods that you've shipped them? Does your current processes or system allow you to capture your supplier's lot and expiry details for the goods that they provide you? For both the U.S. and Canada, this is a requirement today. Today's regulations can be achieved and often as a byproduct of best practices in warehouse and manufacturing execution management, when combined with some basic data sharing between parties. Through the sharing of required data, such as supplier contact, location, and lot details, the buyer can link this information to their inventory or processes, and in turn share the needed data with the next party, their customer, and so forth to the final point or party in the supply chain. The magical part of this scenario is the ability to capture and manage data that was not generated by your own internal processes and systems, which is required to establish the link between your supplier's data and that data that's created by your own processes. Many systems are not designed to allow you to easily extend your data model without significant customizations, which are costly to not only install, but even costlier to maintain over time through upgrades. Today's traceability solutions should not share this problem. A modern solution should have an extensible data model and tools to manage the introduction of new data and web service integrations to address these needs as easily as possible. How far can you trace? If you're looking backward, can you go back to your supplier's supplier? Or can you take it back to the grower's fields or the exact fishing boat that brought in the catch? New regulatory acts are looking in this direction, such as the Food Safety and Modernization Act. The goal of traceability regulations is to have a full picture of the chain of custody for food products from raw ingredient from the farmer's seed to all finished goods that contain the raw ingredient for every participant in the food supply chain. The ultimate expression of this would be a single governing system that collects and aggregates all the data, providing instant access to all parties that touched a specific food item until it's finally consumed. However, this goal is not easily achieved and for many reasons, but certainly to include differences between governing agencies and nations. As a middle ground, new requirements are requiring each party to be able to see back to their supplier's supplier or forward to their customer's customer. While this might be a daunting goal, it is actually fairly easily supported by modern traceability solutions. The requirement simply requires the ability to collect more data and maintain relationships in that data. The bigger challenge will be on gaining visibility to your customer's customer. Assuming that they can provide you with this information, the bigger issue is going to be that of timing. If there's any significant lag between your sale and that of your customer's sale, ensuring that the data can be linked might present some challenges for organizations that have archived the data from their systems, leaving this second level of customer data without a home, as it were, because there's nothing left back to tie it back to. How comprehensive are the reports and analytics that you use today? And are they easy to understand? Does your reporting cover all of your production through all of time? Everything that we've been viewing to this point all leads to reporting and analytics. If you're able to capture the required data, then it needs to be easily accessible and ideally in a highly visible format. In the example shown, you can see a traceability tree that's three levels deep, meaning that the item in the gray box that's circled on the left has multiple ingredients that came from multiple sources and processes that you see going to the right. If you were to drill into the finished good item, you're presented with a disposition of all the lots, either in the production facility, inventory, or shipped items, along with the contact information and the destination details, as is seen on the screen now. Preparing yourself today for future needs is one of the more difficult challenges you face when selecting technology solutions. Do your current solutions allow you to easily restructure your traceability capabilities when recipes or sources of supply or just the supply chain nodes change? Our businesses and our technology solutions need to be able to adapt to our current environment, much like our chameleon friend here. For example, how easily does your current solution adapt to new requirements, such as data elements, so the temperature or lot ID? Or maybe it's process changes, such as a customer compliant label or packing instructions. Or maybe it's the addition of a new partner or nodes in the process as your supply chain adapts and changes over time. One constant we all know to be true, whether regulatory, market, or internally driven, change will happen, and you want to be prepared to adapt to new requirements as easily as possible. The final criteria for measuring a traceability solution is also often the long pole in the tent, and that's integration. How well does your current traceability system integrate with your current processes and other information systems? There are a lot of choices when it comes to integration between systems and specifically with external parties. Ideally, you want to avoid systems that utilize their own proprietary languages and look for solutions that utilize a service-oriented architecture and a modern web services communication model. We've spent the past 35 minutes or so talking about the importance of traceability systems and the 11 criteria by which you can evaluate them. To help make this session a bit more actionable, I suggest that you evaluate your own traceability systems against these 11 criteria. We tried to make that process a little easier by preparing an evaluation matrix pictured here. The matrix is designed to help you evaluate your current traceability processes and systems according to each of the 11 criteria that we've discussed today, along with measuring the economic value drivers to your organization. Companies have limited resources and must be selective about which initiatives to pursue. The obvious way to set priorities among competing priorities is to assign economic value to each of them. The initiatives with the highest economic value rise to the top of the priority list. Economic value can be understood by how an initiative impacts your risk reduction, reduction of costs, increase in revenue or growth, or an increased value to your customer or client. By ranking the importance of each of the valuation criteria to the economic impact that you quickly can see where your traceability capabilities and processes support your business or potentially need additional work. In closing, should you like to download the evaluation matrix that we were just viewing, the link is provided on the screen and then also within the presentation it's a linkable download as well. It's been a pleasure to share with you on the topic of traceability, and I'd like to open up our remaining time for any questions that you might have.
Jeff, none have come through, but if anyone does have any, please feel free to go ahead and type them in, and we'll see what we can do to get those answered for you. I'll give it just a couple moments.
All right. And then as well, my email address is on there. If you have any questions that you'd like to follow up with, please don't hesitate to send me an email.
All right. Well, it doesn't look like anybody has any questions. You did a very good job. And I spoke too soon. So one question came through. You talked about some serious impacts of not having a traceability solution in place. How can Generics Group help fill these gaps?
Sure. So they were very specifically focused on the portion of your supply chain where you're going to be looking at and managing warehouse facilities or a manufacturing execution process. From the moment an item enters into that process, the generic solutions will help you maintain all of this level of detail about those products that can be extended backwards towards the supplier by keeping track of any information that you are able to glean from their processes, say such as a lot number or potentially an expiry date or temperature controlled for an item that's being moved in a temperature controlled means. And then through your own processes, whether that be simply storage and distribution, or if you have a downstream process where you're mixing or processing the good further, all of the detail about that product while it's within your supply chain, including, you know, say multiple lot numbers as raw ingredients are moved through a mixing or a cooking process, and finally arriving at a finished item that would then be sold. So within that window of your processes, plus looking backwards to anything that your suppliers, and that can go back many levels, but whatever you're able to gather there can also continue or can be associated with the goods. And then that information then can be shared out to your customers and then ultimately at the farthest level to your customers' customers.
All right, thank you. And then another question to add to this. So does your solution manage the inventory and manufacturing as well?
Yes. The solutions is a full comprehensive warehouse management capabilities along with manufacturing execution and the movement of, say, raw or intermediate goods that you have within your inventory through a manufacturing process and then turning that into a finished item through that process. And all the inventory levels, processes surrounding all of those can all be controlled through the by the technology.
Do you have any customers on NAV currently?
Yes, we do. Actually, we have quite a few that are NAV customers or users, and on multiple versions for that matter.
And do you have integration with NAV?
Yes, we do. We have a standard integration model with NAV that allows us to kind of have a quick start, gives us a common interface between NAV in terms of its basic setup, and then it can also be tailored to adapt to any customizations that you might have performed against NAV yourself.
All right. Well, thank you very much for the presentation and for answering the questions. If anybody has any additional questions and you would like to contact Jeff, or you can contact Innovia Consulting, one of your account reps, feel free to do so. But I just want to thank everyone for attending, and thank you for the informative information on food traceability, Jeff. I hope everybody got a little bit of takeaway from this presentation.
Great, thank you.
And I just want to remind everyone that this has been recorded, so it will be available for you to review again or share with anyone later this week on our website at innovia.com. And feel free to also check out our events page. We have more events coming up this year, as well as some of our staff will be in San Diego at Directions. So if you'd like to meet any of them, you're more than welcome to. And then we'll also be at Summit Phoenix, October 15th through the 18th. We are at booth 529. We'd be happy to meet any of your colleagues that are attending Summit, so please feel free to stop by our booth 529 so we can get to know you. All right. Thank you again, everyone, and we look forward to seeing you on one of our future webinars or at one of the conferences. Have a great day.